I just want to express my appreciation for all the news media stations and print media also for covering this very important issue for our community. You folks are actually in this together with us, because we can't talk to the people of Oahu through any venue, but you help to carry that message out to our community, so it's a very important message. I just want to say mahalo. Really appreciate it. So today, you know, the Board of Water Supply is pleased with Hearing Officer Day's decision to uphold the Department of Health's emergency order in its entirety. After listening to and carefully considering nearly 12 hours of testimony, arguments, and thousands of pages of exhibits, Hearings Officer Day correctly concluded that the operation of the Red Hill Bug Fuel Storage Facility constitutes an imminent peril to human health and the environment, and affirmed the emergency order requiring defueling of the Red Hill fuel tanks. The draft decision provides a clear and well-reasoned assessment of the damage that has occurred and that will occur if the Navy is allowed to continue to operate that facility as it currently exists, and concludes that it cannot be safely operated as currently configured. The Board of Water Supply agrees with the reasoning in the decision and is hopeful that the order will be finalized to take actions required to protect our irreplaceable groundwater resources from imminent peril posed by the Red Hill fuel tanks. The Navy should immediately comply with the Department of Health's emergency order for the sake of our aquifer, and if they have any hope of rebuilding trust with our community that they have lost. So that's our statement from the Board of Water Supply. We appreciate Hearings Officer Day's draft decision and order, and we hope that by later tomorrow that will be final. And we pray and ask Keakua to somehow touch the hearts of the Navy to say, don't fight this. Admit that this fuel facility has outlived its usefulness and it's time to move it and to empty that fuel out for the sake of our aquifer and for our community and for our future. Thank you. All right, I'll take any questions. If you can.
Yeah, I'm Peter with Hawaii News Now. Do you think the fuel can be safely removed from the tanks?
You know, somehow that fuel got into those tanks and they had to be pumped and unloaded from Pearl Harbor and pumped all the way up the hill. And that probably just occurred recently. So if the Navy feels that it's unsafe to remove the fuel from the tanks, then my question to the Navy is, why are you still using that facility if you feel it's unsafe to unload the fuel right now? But I realize that we have to take a reasoned, rational approach that is protective of the human health and the environment. That if the Navy feels that due to recent developments they need to do some corrective measures to be able to safely unload the fuel, then so be it. They just need to comply with the Department of Health's order. Although it allows them some time, I would urge them to act with urgency, with a sense of urgency that we need to protect the environment, protect the water resources, protect our community from fuel contamination. Christina?
Hi, Christina with Civil Beat. It's my understanding that the DOH order kind of leaves open the possibility that if the Navy takes certain steps, they could, you know, drain the tanks, but then refuel them at some point in the future. How do you feel about that?
I don't agree with that, although I respect and support fully the order by the Department of Health, because over the last 8 years of working on this, I really appreciate the Department of Health at this time, at this point in time, taking such an aggressive measures. If the Navy tries to bring fuel back into that facility, we said in the past that if they double wall these tanks and they have to double wall the pipelines too, that might be a possibility. But I think at this point, given the latest developments, our position is the fuel should be relocated to locations that do not put our aquifer at risk. And there are other locations on this island that they can safely do that.
Do you think the Navy will submit any exceptions?
Do you mind going to the microphone?
Do you think the Navy will submit any exceptions to the proposal by tomorrow's deadline?
You know, unfortunately, having dealt with the Navy on this issue for nearly 8 years now, I think that's always a possibility. But I just want to let you know and let our community know that if the Navy does contest the proposed decision and order by the hearings officer, we are going to be there to stay with this fight. This fight for the protection of our water resources and for our community. The Board of Water Supply will not give up. We are in this for the long haul. We've been in for 8 years. We'll not stop. And I'm not trying to threaten the Navy, but understand that you are going to need to deal with us, whether you like it or not. I would ask the Navy to just wake up, to understand that this is an extremely serious situation, and to move that fuel immediately, and to look at new facilities elsewhere.
Has President Biden responded to the letter you sent last week?
I haven't heard anything from the President. I know he's a very busy person right now, and but I hope that he would take the time to read our letter and to do something about it. Because I believe, you know, he has built his campaign, his platform on the issues of the environment and the issues of our community. You know, this is about environmental justice and social justice for our community. We need the Navy and the President to step up and to move that fuel out of there for the sake of our community. So I hope the President would listen.
How binding are any agreements or rulings, and can the EPA be involved in some way? It seems that when I've spoken to them, that they are saying that the Department of Health is the lead agency. How can other branches of watching over, and how can they get involved?
Well, you know, in terms of legally binding issues, I'm not an attorney, so I really can't respond to that part of the question. But the Department of Health has clear authority delegated by the EPA. There is a bill being proposed in the City Council that'll come up for hearing probably in January. I think it's Bill 48. That would allow the city and county to take on a more aggressive role in regulating these types of facilities.
And as far as other agencies of oversight, like the EPA?
The EPA should, I think, be much more aggressive in this situation. I think they're providing technical support and some staff support to the Department of Health. But ultimately, these are federal regulations. So I'll tell you, just in dealing with the EPA and the DOH over the last 8 years, you know, I think they could have been both more aggressive in the past. And right now, there's a new regional administrator for Region 9 in the EPA. I haven't met her yet, but we'll be reaching out to the new regional administrator at Region 9 and ask her to take a much more aggressive role in protecting our water resources and protecting our community.
Will the Board of Water Supply see if the Navy does not act?
I just say simply, all options are on the table. So the Navy should understand that, that we are committed to take any option necessary to protect our water resources. That is our public trust responsibility in the state of Hawaii, and according to our constitution, that the state government and even city government or local government has a trust responsibility to protect these water resources that are public trust resources for our community and not owned by any individual or any entity like the U.S. Navy.
What are your thoughts on how the Navy's progressions in the flushing efforts, and what's your confidence of having the contamination?
First of all, you know, we haven't had any experience with fuel contamination in our water system, in the pipes. So I'm not sure how effective what the Navy is going to help, what the Navy is doing that's been approved by the Department of Health. I wish them the best. I hope it's effective, but I really don't know for sure if it will be successful. The test results of the testing will, I think, will be determine if the flushing is successful or not. I think they're going to encounter challenges. You know, like we serve a million people drinking water every day. We have 170,000 meters in the system. Building the trust and confidence of your customers, of the people we serve, is something that we take very seriously. And we know that once that trust is lost, it's a difficult road to rebuild that trust. So I can anticipate, I think the Navy is going to have a challenge with their customers and rebuilding the trust with their customers on the safety of their drinking water. I wish them the best. It will be a tough haul.
Do you think the Navy has been downplaying this crisis just overall?
All I know is that I think they seem to be much more, especially when people started to complain about fuel in their drinking water. But now, you know, you see some of the strategies that we've seen in the past, that every leak, they're going to take the approach that, oh, we've addressed it, we've mitigated it, it'll never happen again. And then life goes on, the facility continues to operate. I'm starting to hear some of that, like in the contested case hearing on the emergency order, some familiar strains of a strategy they've used in the past. And I'm disappointed with that. I know they can do better. They just need to wake up. So whether or not the Navy is taking this seriously remains to be seen. The decisions will have to come out of the leadership of the U.S. Navy and the Department of Defense.
In the hearing, we heard the AOC come up a lot, that order on consent. Can you kind of, for the layman who doesn't maybe know what that is, can you explain what that agreement is and how the Department of Health, you know, holds the Navy into account in regards to the AOC?
I'm not an expert on the AOC, and it's got a lot of different pieces, so to explain it to the community, we could take a lot more time. It is a voluntary agreement that was signed back in 2015, I think around September 2015, between the parties that are involved here. The owner of the facility, the U.S. Navy, the owner of the fuel, the Defense Logistics Agency of the Department of Defense, the Department of Health, and the U.S. EPA. And earlier there was a question about EPA involvement. And that voluntary agreement was to work together to develop a plan and implement strategies to allow the facility to continue to operate while still being protective of the environment of the community. It's a voluntary plan. It has about, in its statement of work, which is in an appendix within the AOC, I think there are 7 or 8 sections, and they cover different topics or components of the issue they feel that, if addressed, should provide strategies that can be implemented and revisited every 5 years to keep the facility operating safely. Unfortunately, after 6 years, there hasn't been really much progress made. There's back and forth. Navy will submit a 500 or 600 page report with recommendations. The regulators will come back eventually with comments. It'll go back and forth with that. So very little progress. And in my mind, and I've said this before in front of the City Council hearing, I think the ALC process has really failed. Because look at the position we're in right now. A major leak that's actually impacted directly a drinking water source for the Navy, and it's allowed contaminated water to be supplied to their customers. You know, that's a terrible situation. Did the AOC preclude that from happening? Did it stop it from happening? My answer to that is no. Do we throw away the AOC work? I am not sure. There are components that maybe should be revisited. The AOC does allow for amendments to be made. Maybe they need to look at serious amendments to the AOC to make it work. But really, this is something we've said from the very beginning. Time is working against us with this facility. 8 years ago, you know, this facility was 72 years old, 71 years old. And now we are 8 years later, and still there's no real progress under the AOC. And look what happened just recently, shortly after Thanksgiving. So if a process needs to be kept, it needs to be a process that allows for quick action and quick decisions by the regulators to hold the Navy's feet to the fire. Sorry, it's a long answer to a short question.
Ernie, you've talked about how with the Halava shaft closed and additional BWS wells shuttered as well, we're getting water from other wells that are not contaminated and there's not fear of contamination there. How are we doing on water levels right now at those places?
Yeah, right now, Christina, thank you for the question about the how are we doing with our other wells that are making up the loss of three BWS wells from our system. I think we're holding our ground. It's been raining, so water demand is lower, and it's also been cool. But the test will be, like we said before, it'll be when we get into the hot, dry summer months, when we don't anticipate being able to turn on those wells even by then. So that'll be the test. And again, you know, the ask for our customers, the Kokua, to help us conserve water and not waste it, those are going to become very important as we get into the summer months especially. Are there any other questions?
I just wanted to sort of ask, as far as the aquifer, is this the primary aquifer for Honolulu?
As you saw in the for Honolulu, it represents, you know, from Halava Shaft, about 20% of our supply that we provide water to the city of Honolulu, from the Halava area all the way out to Hawaiʻi. For the island, I think between the three wells, it's probably closer to 10% of our total supply. If you looked in the hearings officer decision and order, he describes the whole aquifer, the southern Oahu basal aquifer, a sole source aquifer, as supplying 74% of the water for the island of Oahu. Okay.
In regards to the wells that are shut down, what has to happen in order for you guys to use it again?
That is the big question right now. Because number one, our priority is not to repeat what the Navy is experiencing right now with their customers and their petroleum contaminants getting into their water system. We cannot allow that to happen to the border water supply system. So to me, that is a zero tolerance for that to happen. So if we turn on Halava shaft, IA wells, Halava wells, we have to have 100% confidence that fuel contaminants that are moving with the groundwater won't be pumped into those wells, into the pipes that we use water, transmit water to our customers. So at this point, I'm not sure what that 100% confidence will be. Definitely, it's trying to define what has already been leaked into the ground, how much has been leaked. With the most recent leaks, I'll pause here. So it's identifying what has leaked recently and in the past, where it is in the groundwater, where is the groundwater flowing, and if we turn on our wells, will we be able to draw the contamination with the water into our wells? We need to have really 100% confidence in that it won't happen before we turn them back on. So I think the bottom line here is, I think our community should not expect us to turn those wells on in the near future. They could be off for quite a while.
Okay.
We are going to be, issuing a op-ed on Civil Beat. I don't know when it's going to come out, but you can. We do talk about a worst-case scenario in there, and the actions that we would contemplate under the worst-case scenario.
Are either you or Mr. Kawada able to say something about the hearing process and just how that played out? And any sort of stance the Board of Water Supply has on the hearing process and how that went?
In terms of the contested case process, I only viewed it, and my associate, Mr. Erwin Kawata, was a witness within that process and also represented the Board of Water Supply. I'd like to say that nearly 12 hours of testimony and thousands of pages of exhibits, I thought it was a process that gave the community insight on the perspectives or positions of the different parties. So I just want to express our appreciation for the State of Hawaii, the Department of Health, the Office of the Attorney General, in their pleading their case to uphold their emergency order. Also, I appreciate the support of the Sierra Club as an intervener in that process, also stating their position. And to the Board of Water Supply team, our legal team and experts, and Mr. Kawata. Together, I think we put up a strong argument that this emergency order should be upheld. And I'm glad to say that Hearings Officer Day agreed with that. And it's upholding the emergency order in its entirety. It's important that we continue to work together, all of us in the community, the different regulatory agencies, government entities, non-governmental organizations like the Sierra Club and others, that we stay on top of this issue, which is extremely important for our community. And by this effort of working together, that we can move this mountain, we can take on this Goliath and have them change their heart to realize that they can no longer operate this facility safely at that location and to move it. But it's all of us working together. I use the analogy like we are all these little thin sticks, but when you put them together in a bundle, these sticks by themselves that are weak in by themselves and not strong, it can be easily broken. But when you put it together in a bundle, and you tie that bundle together with the principles and the values of Kauai Ola, water is life, that ties all of us that maybe have differences of opinions, bring us all together into this bundle that's tied with the fundamental principle that water is life, Kauai Ola, then we can be strong. We can move, we can do things that we cannot do alone. And working together, I believe, and it is my hope that we can accomplish this. We can accomplish this for our future.
You hinted about worst case scenario in the op-ed. Would you be able to share a little bit about what that scenario looks like?
Yeah, unfortunately, the worst case scenario is simply the Navy refuses to move the fuel out of Red Hill, that they insist on continuing to use that facility for as long as they want to. And right now, they've tied a number of 2045. They want to be able to be given up to 2045 to continue to use that facility. And if they haven't upgraded it to secondary containment, then they would take it out of service. 2045 is a long way away. It's a long time from now, and we cannot afford to wait. So the worst case scenario is the Navy doesn't change its mind, it maintains that position, and we have no choice but to permanently consider the shutdown of Halawa Shaft, Halawa Well, and Aiea Well. And how we deal with that, we're working on the solutions there.
When I spoke to you previously, you said that the same access tunnels for Red Hill, for the fuel storage facility, and the water line wells were the same access tunnels. Is that? I just wanted to see if you could elaborate on that. In other words, during the construction of the fuel storage facility, they knew there was an aquifer there.
Yes, they did, because they built their own Red Hill shaft or Red Hill well as a water source for Pearl Harbor. And it's tapping the aquifer that's only 100 feet below the bottoms of these tanks. So the Red Hill pumping station is physically connected to the same tunnel that carries the fuel to and from Pearl Harbor, the same lower access or lower tunnel that carries all the fuel pipelines. There is a physical connection to that tunnel. So the pump room where their pumps are for Red Hill Well or Red Hill Shaft is, you walk through the lower tunnel that is meant for the fuel facility, and you can walk right into the pump room where the Navy's drinking water source is. In fact, I think some of you may have been in there while they demonstrated, the Navy divers working under difficult conditions to try to suction out the fuel that's floating on the water, dripping on the walls. You've probably been in that room. If you went a little further more into the tunnel, you would have seen the pipelines that bring fuel to and from the 20 tanks to Pearl Harbor. And in that pipeline, in that tunnel that you walked into to get to the pump room, that's the area they suspect they had a November 20th leak that spilled fuel and water on the ground, got into a drain, and got into a drain system underneath the tunnel floor, and seeped down into the rock, into the aquifer.
Just one more thing. You know, they were talking about the recovery of fuel in the hearing, and the Navy was claiming that they had recovered, in regards to, when was it, the May incident surge, was that, that they had recovered all but a couple dozen gallons. That was talked about in the hearing. Can you elaborate a little on what the Navy's claims were and whether those can be substantiated as far as their ability to recover fuel in the way that they are claiming?
So your question is something that I think is the subject of their investigation, and the regulators are going to be seeking the results of that investigation. I can only speculate based on my visit to the tunnel, to the facility with Congressman Cahilly, that the leak that occurred on May 6th, and this is Ernie Lau's opinion, based on my discussions with some of the Navy staff that were very open to answering my questions, that when they had the pressure surge on May 6th in the fuel pipeline, and this is the fuel pipeline carrying JP5. It's a 16-inch diameter pipeline, so it's a pretty large pipe. That pressure surge was caused the pipeline to burst open, to fail right near tank number 20. And a section of pipe that was connected to that 16-inch pipeline basically came loose or broke loose and allow fuel to gush out into that lower access tunnel. I think when they were finally, they told me when they were finally able to get in there, they thought all the fuel had been contained, because there is also a sump further down from that tank that is used to actually capture, if they had a fire in the facility, the foam and water that would come out of their fire suppression system would fill this sump and be pumped into the AFFF drain line, or fire suppression system drain line. So the sump is about 1,600 gallons in capacity. So they didn't think the pumps that would drain that sump and pump it into the drain line ran. But later on, they discovered that it did run. And these are large capacity pumps. And it pumped it directly into the fire suppression system drain line. And that's the drain line that broke on November 20th near the Red Hill shaft, and allowed that mixture of fuel and water to spill onto the floor of the tunnel and eventually seep down into the aquifer. And that's my speculation based on my discussions with some of the Navy staff. I want to see their final investigative report Also, I would like that report to be unredacted. The problems we've seen in Navy documents, and for national defense or for whatever reason, they redact pretty heavily. But this report, I think, is going to be critical for everybody to understand what happened. The thing to keep in mind, though, is whatever they do to address that particular failure doesn't mean they can address the next failure or next leak in that facility. And the hearings officer was correct in his assessment that there will be more leaks. It's almost inevitable. And for that reason, the field sheet should be removed as quickly as possible.